We're here today with Jeff Crudele, the host and creator of JFK The Enduring Secret podcast. Jeff, welcome to Solving JFK.
Thanks for having me on the show. I'm just excited to be here with you.
Today, we're going to cover recaps and rebuttals from the all the Dealey Plaza episodes, kind of go through each issue, and basically Jeff and I will chat through the issues and kind of come up with our respective positions, I guess. You know, when I first started looking at doing this podcast, there weren't really, there were a couple of podcasts that were sort of dedicated on the conspiracy side, but there wasn't really anything that went in order, issue by issue, really trying to sort of cover everything when I started this project. And then probably the week after I checked, that's when your first episode came out. And I went back at, you know, around the time we did the launch for Solving JFK to see, hey, is there anything else out there in the time since? And you have so many episodes. I mean, you've really done a heck of a job. How many episodes do you have so far, would you say?
156.
Wow. Yeah. I've probably listened to about 20% of them, but I've got my work cut out for me. I would say if you look at all the JFK podcasts, Jeff has the most reviews, the best reviews on Apple. I mean, if you're going to look at podcasts that just focus on the JFK assassination, I think it's hard to argue any point other than Jeff's is the number one that exists. So thanks for coming on, Jeff. We appreciate it.
Well, thank you. Those are really kind remarks. And actually, one of the reasons that I'm on is because I discovered yours. Actually, one of the fans from our show let me know that yours was out, and I listened to it, and it's terrific. I'm here because it's, you know, you're just one of those really intelligent people that can put it together, put together a really incohesive topic into something that's quite cohesive. And that's been my objective, or one of my objectives from the very beginning. I'm probably a little bit more into the storytelling piece of it, because that's just me. That's my personality. But it's really hard. I think we all struggle with the enormity of detail that's behind all this, and to try to make some sense of it.
In Dallas, Texas, three shots were fired at President Kennedy's motorcade in downtown Dallas. The first reports say that President Kennedy has been seriously wounded by this shooting.
The flash, apparently official, President Kennedy died at 1 p.m. Central Standard Time.
I don't know what this is all about.
Dallas police this morning resumed custody of the man they have formally charged with the assassination of President Kennedy.
I'm just a part of it.
The man is Lee Oswald.
Was Oswald acting alone, or was he a member of a conspiracy? Commission answers, he acted alone.
Well, hey, let's go ahead and get into it here. So there's four episodes of the podcast of Solving JFK that we're going to kind of recap here. Episodes 9 through 12, and these are the Dealey Plaza episodes. And, you know, there's so many things going on in Dealey Plaza. I'm sure there are things that I've left out, or, you know, if you notice anything that I obviously left out, feel free to jump in on that. But we'll kind of just go in order here. So the first question is, was there someone impersonating Secret Service on the Knoll in Dealey Plaza? So the arguments that there were are around the testimony of Officer Joe Smith, who says that he sees a guy who shows him Secret Service credentials. And then also Deputy Constable Seymour Weitzman says that he sees a Secret Service agent. Then you have two witnesses that are not officers that are maybe a little bit, you know, Gordon Arnold is sort of controversial. He said he gives a whole story about how the guy's like crying and he's got a gun in his hands and the same dirty fingernails that Officer Smith saw. But there's no really way to prove that Gordon Arnold was there, I don't think. So I'm not sure if how much weight you could put on that. There's one more officer, D.D. Harkness, who says that he saw saw Secret Service behind the book depository minutes after. So I mean, the counterpoints would be that Gordon Arnold's not reliable. Malcolm Summers doesn't tell the same story as everybody else. And these people, you know, Joe Smith and Seymour Weitzman and D.B. Harkness, all the law enforcement, they must have just been mistaken. So what are your thoughts on that? I guess you can go first and I'll jump.
Well, I think there were folks impersonating Secret Service officers there. I think it's almost a given. There's a couple of things. There's maybe one other counter point that you know, should be given some thought. According to testimony that Robert Jones gave at the HSCA, Jones was head of the military investigative units of the 112th. He said that there were between 8 and 12 individuals from that group there in Dallas that day, and they routinely, in circumstances like what happened that day, would be involved in presidential security. And because there was such an overlap in what they did, it was his testimony under oath that they potentially could have been addressed as Secret Service agents and just said yes to it. But there are circumstances where people presented credentials, and the testimony is that the credentials stated they were Secret Service. So that, you know, clearly would be in contravention of that. So I at the end of the day, it's my opinion that the fact that there were people who represented themselves as Secret Service agents, and the inventory of true Secret Service agents shows there would have been none in the Plaza that day. I think it's incontrovertible that somebody was misrepresenting themselves in the Plaza. For what purpose exactly? I mean, obviously, likely to be part of the conspiracy to effectuate the event.
Right. So it's possible that there was somebody impersonating Secret Service in Dealey Plaza, not as part of a conspiracy, but not. Plausible. This seems pretty unlikely if that's going to be happening. I land where you land. I don't know if I go strong conspiracy or leans conspiracy, but I'm kind of in between because you've got two law enforcement that see the guy at the top of the knoll, and that's putting aside everything, you know, from Gordon Arnold and Malcolm Summers and Ed Hoffman. So on Gordon Arnold, just quickly, and we'll go to the next episode. Do you have an opinion about his credibility?
I'm on the fence with him. There are elements of his. First of all, it wasn't under oath.
Sure.
So I have a little bit different view of it than I would others. Secondly, there's enough nuances in the different versions of the stories that he told that. That also makes me wonder a bit.
Mm-hmm.
And there's just some hyperbole in the middle of it that if you're a trained eye, you take pause at.
I think you can, the way I look at Gordon Arnold is kind of related to how I look at Ed Hoffman, which is maybe it's true, but if you can't hang your whole hat on that testimony. If anything, it's got to be a cherry on top if that's what you're, you know, if you're trying to say there's a conspiracy.
Another factor for me is whether or not these witnesses over time attempted to commercialize the knowledge that they had. And, you know, that doesn't in and of itself make someone nefarious by any stretch. I'm not saying that, but, you know, he really never they sought him and found him. He didn't try to find the media. And so I do think if you're plusing and minusing the things about Gordon Arnold, I do think you have to give him credit for the idea that he wasn't trying to take what is incredibly sensational testimony and commercialize it. So I think that has some value in your analysis as well.
Okay. And then just real quick, one more thing from episode 9 that I didn't mention. The photo that Mary Mormon took, and the whole badge man, is there a guy there? I look at that and I can't, you know, a lot of people look at it and they get down to the point of like, it shows the thing, you know, the shot happening in real time. And it's like, it shows a guy with a badge holding a rifle. I see what people are talking about when you look at that, but I don't know that it shows any of that. What I think is more persuasive is that it looks like there could be somebody there. Now, what is the person? Is it, you know, does he have a badge or not? I don't know, but I know Josiah Thompson recreated the Mormon photo with somebody standing in the spot behind the stockade fence, and it looks pretty much like the Mormon photo. So where I land is, I don't get into the Rorschach test of it all. But I think it leaves it open that there could have been somebody there in that picture, but we just don't really know for sure, is my opinion. What do you think?
I think there was definitely somebody there. I don't think that the, at least the versions of the picture that we're seeing, show, enough clarity to have a definitive, certainly they're not good enough to identify who that person was.
Right. Right.
Although I will tell you there has been, some research on, and I don't claim to know much about this because it's not something I studied. Although more recently I had someone who was very involved with it come and talk to me about it. That there's, you know, potentially better versions of that photograph that we have not seen. And remember, it was a Polaroid. So, I mean, by its nature, you know, it's the level of pixel density and clarity of lens and so on and so forth was not good to begin with. But so it's easy for any of us to surmise that it's just a crappy picture. Mm-hmm. when in fact the original of that may have been significantly better in clarity than you think. And so I haven't without getting too far into that, because I don't know, I don't have a lot of background on it. I was actually just talking about it yesterday with somebody. Mm.
Isn't it funny how some people will only know tiny parts of the case and they know the most random things? Like I was talking to someone the other day and all they knew was the babushka lady and the umbrella man. it was the most random things for you to latch on to.
You know, it's kind of like, what gets 100 million views on TikTok or this or that? Mm-hmm. I mean, it's just stuff people like. Wait till you get to the autopsy.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Too bad Siebert and O'Neill didn't have cool nicknames. Yeah. Right. Next issue, Ed Hoffman. So now we're going to episode 10. So Ed Hoffman, just to recap quickly, is the deaf and mute man who claims to have basically seen the conspiracy happen. He claims to have seen a guy that was dressed in a police uniform that held the gun, fired it, tossed it to another guy who broke it down and then ran down the railroad tracks. There's an officer, Tom Tilson, who potentially, you know, you could kind of say, oh, the guy that he saw coming down the hill, maybe that was the railroad guy. I don't know. But the thing with Ed Hoffman is, you know, his story is vociferously disputed, because if it's true, it's game over. I mean, if it's true, then he's just basically saying, I saw the man behind the grassy knoll that you guys are all talking about. I saw him. He went and went to the police. They didn't understand him. And this is after talking to his family. He then, years later, in 1967, he goes back to the FBI. And the report that the FBI writes is, he came in and said that he thought he had seen something, but then he came back and said that he couldn't have seen what he thought he saw. Right. So it's just, it's, I don't know. The question is, why would the guy make it up? Now, his family does vouch for the fact that he was physically present there, and that he was standing on the side of the highway. You know, if you go there to Dealey Plaza, to where the freeway is, it looked to me like it would have been really hard for him to see that from the side of the freeway, but not impossible. Now, also, I think today there's trees there that are probably higher than they were at the time. And
there was nothing there, I don't think. I think it was a clear view.
It would have been a clear view, but, it, you know, probably 200 yards, maybe. The distance,
I think it was 130 yards.
Okay. Well, look at that. Yeah. Cause the distance from the, the railroad tower to the grassy knoll is always, it was further than I thought it would be. I thought it was a lot closer. So, you know, but we're going to get to that here in a second. So anyway, so my summary on Ed Hoffman is I really don't know. I kind of put him in the Gordon Arnold category. I've talked to people who met him and say that he was very credible, and, you know, they believe him. So I definitely leave it open as possible, but I think I land on inconclusive for him. What about you?
I think he's quite conclusive.
Okay, let's hear it.
Yeah, and let me tell you why. I think there's a series of things. First of all, if you're deaf mute, communication by its nature is a challenge. So, and in fact, there are, you know, just like there's sort of, you know, hundreds of languages in our world today, there's hundreds of different ways to interpret signing and so on and so forth, the ways deaf mutes communicate. And some of that is accountable for the variations in some of the things that he has said. And that's been documented. Mm-hmm. But there's a couple of things that I think are really important. Number one, his father, he came home and told his family right away. His father was deathly afraid that somebody of his nature getting involved, which makes complete sense to me. You know, he wanted to protect his son, and he knew that a you know, young man like that would just get bowled over. And, you know, his uncle, the father's brother, was on the Dallas police force.
Right.
And, you know, they did have a conversation where the three of them were together. The father relayed to the brother, to the policeman, what was said. And it was his motivations were clear to leave out any of the details that were associated with that. And I think if you look at statements made subsequent by the family, I think he was very consistent in his articulation of it. And you know, I think shame on the family in the 1967 case, because they had a lot of time to think about it. He had an opportunity to be prepared before he went in to talk to the FBI. By the way, he did see the FBI that week too. That, you know, he went over to the Dallas, you know, to the local authorities right afterward, and it was mayhem, and he couldn't get in there. And he actually purportedly contacted the FBI office within a few days of that, and there was no response. Hmm. back from his contact. So even at that very moment, he was attempting to make some communication. In fact, he makes a statement that right after it happened, he attempted to approach one of the officers on the bridge. That officer subsequently said that it never happened. Mm-hmm. So whether that was, you know, it's pretty easy. And again, in the case of a deaf mute, it's pretty easy to say, no, it never happened.
Right.
And it's just not going to be refuted. I personally believe that he saw something very material. Whether the nuances of it, I get how you could be suspect because some of the interpretations early did not include things like placing disassembled items into a box. Mm-hmm. You know, into it. So I think there are some, you know, potentially some discrepancies. It would have been nice to better dealt with that, but I think he saw something material there, and I think, you know, he ended up, I think, being misinterpreted in certain circumstances. It was easy to dismiss him, but he was very consistent. He led a pretty solid life his whole life, and so I think he is highly credible. Unfortunately, because he couldn't communicate very well, he didn't get much traction.
Sure, yeah, it's unlucky, you know, footnote of history. The guy that would, you know, what he's saying is true. He sees he's the key witness. He's the main guy. You know, people say that he couldn't have seen it because, you know, Lee Bowers should have been able to see it. Well, Lee Bowers does say that he saw two guys there, and Lee Bowers is 150 yards away or so. I mean, it's far. I mean, you know, so it kind of leaves it set up. Now, you've gone through all the evidence. I'm kind of, and obviously, I know a lot more than what episodes we've released so far, but I'm trying to kind of keep it for our audience just within, you know, facts that we're currently looking at. Cause the thing of this case is there's so many things that are inconclusive, And then you find a few here or there that like really lean, you know, one way or the other. And you're like, well, I know that these things kind of give the game away. You know what I mean? And they're different facts for everybody. But I want to talk about the railroad witnesses sort of led by Skinny Holland there. So we've got these three railroad witnesses, and we shared the audio from Mark Lane's Rush to Judgment documentary for a lot of their interviews. And they're unequivocal that shots came from a shot came from the grassy knoll, and then they saw a puff of smoke come out from under the trees right there. Three of them say the exact same thing, and there's a fourth guy. That's one of my rebuttals coming up that also is standing there with him, that whose name I didn't mention. But at any rate, the argument against, so obviously puff of smoke coming out from the grassy knoll, they all said they heard it. The arguments against hearing it are that there's a bad echo in Dealey Plaza, and there, you know, there would have been like a report that they wouldn't have really known where it was coming from. And the other big argument is that there was a steam pipe right there, and you know, maybe they confused it with steam from the steam pipe. But actually, the steam pipe wasn't right there. It was up further. It wasn't right under the trees where they said it was. So I think the steam pipe argument is not a valid argument. I want to hit rebuttal number one, and then I'd love to hear your thoughts on this railroad witnesses. So rebuttal number one is guns don't produce smoke. That's the number one thing. I got a few people that sent me that. And I, you know, I'm a gun owner, and I don't get to shoot nearly as much as I would like to. But the answer is they produce a little bit of smoke, a little bit. Now, back in the day, if you use the old school gunpowder, yes, it was crazy smoke. But even today, just a normal pistol, it's going to have a very small amount, just based on my recollections and the quick research I was able to do. If anyone's got anything definitive on that, feel free to send it to me. But just talking to gun owners, I mean, there is going to be a small puff of smoke, and you know, the density of it could be argued about, but I guess that's just kind of semantics. Your thoughts on the railroad witnesses?
Well, I think Sam Holland is highly credible. He was a former deputy sheriff. If you listen to him, he's highly articulate. He's obviously very detail oriented. He remembers things very specifically. He's unequivocal. And he seems to be an ethical person. There's never been a question about, you know, who he was. And he was a long time employee. I think he was a 25-year employee at the terminal company at the time of the assassination. So I think he's highly credible. I believe what he said.
They all say the same thing, and they're all consistent the whole time. No one ever changes their story, and they're all verified by multiple other people who see the same things.
I do have some of the same, you know, questions and concerns. First, I'm not a gun expert. I mean, I've shot guns before, but I'm not a gun expert at all. And I've wondered about the same thing I've heard, you know, gun owners tell me both stories that yes and no, depending upon the gun and the circumstance and the ammunition involved and so on and so forth. I think the question is, if you're some, you know, 60 to 80 yards away and you see a quote puff of smoke, how big was it?
Right.
You know, I don't think we've ever really understood exactly. Many people saw this. It is in the description that I hear, it is analogous to a firecracker. Everyone says, in fact, if you go to James, you know, you've covered James Tague, and again, I don't want to, you know, we'll wait on that, but he is unequivocal that the first shot, and here's another guy, you know, most of these guys were in the Army or some form of service because of the nature of the timing of all this. You know, you go back to 45 and in the Korean War as well. He unequivocally says the first shot sounded like a firecracker, did not sound like a shot. And, you know, then you see all these puffs of smoke that look exactly like firecrackers. I mean, that's just the most bizarre thing. You almost wonder if somebody threw one, you know, like that. No one's ever said anything like that, but we're grasping, you know, to try to bend the facts around what people saw, when it's not very often that you shoot a gun, you see a large puff of smoke.
Yeah. So there's not going to be a large puff of smoke for sure. Yeah.
What did they see? That is the question. Have you covered all of Lee Bauer's testimony, because he says something very relevant.
Actually, I've got one more rebuttal and then we'll go to Lee Bauer. So rebuttal number two, also on the railroad witnesses, You said that there were four railroad witnesses who saw a puff of smoke, but you only mentioned three in the podcast. Is the fourth one Lee Bowers? No, that's not the fourth one I was referencing. And you're right, I did make a mistake. The fourth one is Austin Lawrence Miller. He gave a same day affidavit, and I will I'll post the link to that in the show notes at the end if you want to take a look at his affidavit. He was standing right there with the other guys. Okay, Lee Bowers, the guy in the railroad tower. Yeah, you can unpack it if you want to. Go ahead.
Well, you do such a magnificent job of talking about who he was. I mean, obviously he was the he sat in the tower, and he made sure that the trains were on the right tracks, and he had a bird's eye view. And actually, the angle of his view is almost—it's not exactly straight down the Elm Street extension, but it's at a slight angle to it, and so you can actually see down into the plaza really clearly, almost at the point at which the motorcade turns from Houston on Elm. It's just, but you lose. From where he's at, you lose sight on Elm Street, but you clearly have a clear view of the parking lot and the back fence there. If there was anyone who should have seen a shooter at the grassy knoll, it was Lee Bowers. I think the question for most people, he was a highly articulate gentleman. He was a smart man. He, in his Warren Commission testimony, when they got to the critical moment at which they he might have offered more, I'm not sure what he might have offered, but he was dissuaded. That was a controversial point, and Mark Lane brought it up when he interviewed him later and rushed to judgment.
Yeah, I want to just quickly comment on that, because that's a counterpoint that people raise to show that, you know, his testimony is not credible. He's telling this to Mark Lane for the first time, which is even one that I raised. But it is true that if you look at his Warren Commission testimony, right at the point where he would have talked about what he saw, they move him on to another topic.
He says that. He makes an explicit statement to Mark Lane in the brush to judgment discussion about that. You know, he figured that the way he was being handled was that he should only answer exactly what was asked of him. That's what they wanted.
So, yeah, I mean, and ultimately what he ends up saying is that he saw a puff of smoke or a flash of light. He's not real clear. Or no, a flash of light. He doesn't say puff of smoke. He says he saw a flash of light, something out of the ordinary.
He's very explicit in his discussion about the three cars.
Mm-hmm.
Entered prior to the assassination, and he has an incredibly detailed description, including one obviously that had a headpiece.
Yeah, walkie-talkie.
Exactly, which is obviously a very excitable circumstance. So you have to believe that there's a reason why he might not have been focused.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
But it's hard to believe. I wonder, you can't fabricate, people say or don't say things, but there's the real question with Lee Bowers is whether he really saw more and he was just too afraid to say anything. And I think there's some potential for that. One of the mysteries about, Lee Bowers, I think, is that he did discuss this with several other people. And this goes to the hearsay question.
Mm-hmm.
Do you believe, certainly hearsay is not admissible in a legal circumstance, but in this circumstance, when you're trying to get to the truth, you want to hear everything. And it does go to the veracity of some of the statements that he made to others. And I really don't have an opinion on that. I think they're all minor and peripheral characters, but there are others who have made statements that he did see more. And was hesitant to say it. You'll probably get some rebuttal to this because really Mark Lane had the opportunity to ask those questions. And was he still so worried at that moment that he couldn't tell Mark Lane, even privately off camera, what he saw? You know, so maybe he didn't. I do think it's still the biggest mystery how the guy who had the only bird's eye view of this whole thing and should have seen absolutely every detail, particularly after he was so good at seeing what happened with those three cars, that he didn't see the rest of this.
He kind of leaves it open-ended, though, with the flash of light and the people driving around with a walkie-talkie. It's like, no, I didn't, you know, I can't say that I saw what Ed Hoffman says he saw exactly, but it's plausible that I did. Like, basically, you know, kind of if you put it all together. So he leaves it open to be possible. All right, let's go into episode 11. I just want to talk about Tip O'Neill real quick. He shared in his book that came out in 1987, when he was the sitting speaker of the House. He was on the way out as the speaker of the House, but he was a speaker. He said that he had dinner with Kenny O'Donnell and Dave Powers, and Kenny O'Donnell told him that he lied to the Warren Commission and that he heard two shots from behind the fence on the grassy knoll. And the FBI basically told him, you know, that's not possible. You didn't hear that, you know, don't cause problems. And he didn't want to cause problems for the Kennedy family. So he went along with it and changed the story. I do have a rebuttal on this topic, which is that Dave Powers, the other, so Kenny O'Donnell died in 1977. The book comes out in 1987. So he's not there to speak for himself. But Dave Powers, who was there and was also in the car and was supposedly also at this,
dinner.
Dave Powers says that's not true and that, you know, none of this ever happened. But you would, so that's the rebuttal. And okay, I'm putting that out there. That is true. Dave Powers said that. There's a newspaper article where Dave Powers is saying, you know, this is reckless for Tip O'Neill to say this. It's not true. He's lying. It doesn't make sense to me that Tip O'Neill would just make it up. I don't understand what clout he would have to gain having already been at the top of the mountain. It wasn't to sell a book. It was one page in the book. He's going to sell books anyway. So to me, that one leans conspiracy pretty heavy, I think. But what are your thoughts on the Tip O'Neill stuff?
Well, when I listen to your episode on it, I think you're spot on. I think your analysis is, you know, I don't think Tip O'Neill did this to sell a book. I do think that, you know, he had no reason not to tell the truth. And I think he did tell the truth about this. I have it on pretty good authority that, and it's relatively well documented generally, that Robert Kennedy, almost from the very moment that this happened, knew that the only way they would get to the truth of it is, you know, certainly not in the current, you know, under the current administration. I mean, he vowed privately later on that if he won the election in 68, that he was going to go hard at it. But he did everything he could after that moment to dissuade, you know, sort of the family, particularly anybody in the family, getting involved in endorsing any sort of conspiracy theory. They did a lot of private investigative work themselves through Walter Sheridan and others. And I think that I think Kenny O'Donnell's statement is right. I think at that moment and for some period beyond, they really wanted this put to bed. They didn't want the speculation of it for a number of reasons, and some directly related to consequences around Robert. Mm-hmm. So I think it's quite a plausible series of circumstances that led to what you just described, and it's very consistent. And so I think they saw what they saw, and I think they were told to shut up about it. And I think they did. And I think they did because they had a level of loyalty to the family. And I think his statement's true.
Okay. The next issue would be the spacing of the shots. So there's a great, research article online. It's actually a law review article from some Canadian law school, and it lays out, he's got every single thing is cited to every single deposition or affidavit, and lays out that 47 people are on record saying that the pattern of the shots was shot, pause, shot, shot, and that the second two shots, basically, they came so close together, a lot of people say almost simultaneously, you know, or they'll, it's hard to get in writing because people were, you know, it's an audio timing thing. People were like, the shots sounded like pow, 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 you know, like, so that's kind of hard to capture. But the whole issue is if it's a bolt action rifle, there's going to be a certain amount of time in between shots required because you'd have to operate the bolt. So, you know, what is that number exactly? I don't remember what they determined it. It was like 1.9 seconds or 2 point something. I don't know. But the point is it couldn't be simultaneous, which is what 47 witnesses say. Now people will argue they didn't say simultaneous. They said it was the second two were closer than the first two. Okay. All right. I want to hit rebuttal number four real quick and then get your thoughts on this. Rebuttal number four is that I addressed everyone's statements on the timing of the shots and the location that they thought the shots came from, who was in the motorcade going back to the Secret Service follow-up car. But I left out that Nellie Connolly said that the shots were evenly spaced. So I didn't come across that, but you know, I wasn't trying to leave that on purpose. So yeah, there's a person who says they're evenly spaced. That doesn't change the 47 people, many of five of whom were in the Secret Service follow-up car, that or the driver of the president's limo that all said, you know, there were two shots in quick succession. But what are your thoughts on the spacing of the shots?
Well, I think the Zapruder film is very clear that you know, there was likely shots, you know, that were less than the 2.2 seconds that is required to load and reload and reshoot.
2.2, like there you
Americana.
Go.
So I mean, that's one aspect of it. But taking a step back from all this, because I went down this rat hole too, as you know, it is a rat hole because first of all, eyewitness testimony has enough variation in it. And then you get into ear witness testimony, which is a real problem because the acoustics in Dealey Plaza, by their very nature, are going to cause a lot of problems for, you know, people who are really trying to tell the truth and tell you what they heard. And still, you still get a lot of variation. I think your hope is that you get this statistical population that settles down to a normal distribution and, you know, you can somehow make a conclusion around it. Maybe you can. I tried that. I didn't get comfortable with it. It's almost not reconcilable. But I would say this, that in, and I've heard people tell me this too, in an environment where the acoustics, have a lot of reverberation, if you have multiple shots that happen almost simultaneously, they can sound like one. You know, at the end of the day, that may account for the fact that there were more shots than even people were saying generally, but that they happened almost simultaneously, particularly the headshots, and that may account for some of the, you know, the delta. I don't know that we're ever going to know, because, you know, there's so much question mark in the autopsy about the evidence of the number of shots. Is very problematic. You haven't gotten to that part yet, but when you do, you'll that's another rat hole you'll go
through. I've started cleaning up the, so all these episodes, the meat and potatoes of each one, you know, probably 80% of each episode is recorded like a year ago, and then as I get to it, I spot check it, you know, do a little bit of additional research and kind of put it out. And I went back and listen to the medical episode and looked at all that. We're going to have six episodes, it looks like, which I know you, what do you have, like 25 30, episodes, 30? 30.
Yeah. I was looking the other day. I might be 31 or 32. Yeah. It's unbelievable. I mean, I ramble, you know, I talk too much and say too little sometimes, but you could still do, you could go on forever almost.
Yeah. It's all out there for you. Go listen to JFK, The Enduring Secret, and then come back to my podcast, but listen to all of his too. All right. But let's go on to Umbrella Man and Dark Complected Man. Okay. So one of the trademark characters, the Umbrella Man. Hey, yeah. All right. There's the guy he's got an umbrella. He's near the road and it's a sunny day in Dallas and nobody else has an umbrella. And he opens the umbrella as soon as the motorcade comes by. He's standing right there on the curb. And then there's another guy, the dark complected man, as he's come to be known, skinny, tall, dark complected guy. And he's got his fist up in the air and he's like, all of a sudden starts to put his fist in the air when the president comes. And the two of these guys are two of the closest people to the limo. The argument from the conspiracy side of things is that these guys were signalers for the assassination team. And then the counter argument is no, Stephen Louis Witt, or is it Louis Stephen Witt, whatever his name is, Witt, okay, came forth for the HSCA and said that he was the umbrella man. And he says that he's, you know, protesting Kennedy's dad's association with Neville Chamberlain. Okay. That's the official story. And then, but the official story on the dark complected man is, red herring. Don't worry about it. We're fine. But we never figured out who he was. Nobody knows who he is. So where I land on this is that the umbrella man, I think it's possible that Witt is telling the truth. I reserve the possibility that he's telling the truth. I think it's a coin toss as to whether he's telling the truth. I very well could see him not telling the truth because he suddenly comes forward. He comes forward after it was like he contacted somebody. I forget the exact details, but the way that he came to light, it was he kind of like inserted himself into it. It wasn't like someone found him. Yeah. And we're basically just going on his word. And then the craziest thing is they sit down next to each other on the curb. And I would say it looks like they were waiting on like their moms to pick them up from soccer practice. Everybody else is they're either running up the hill or they're ducking, trying to avoid the shots. And these guys are just like sitting there like going, man, why is mom taking so long? You know what I mean? Like, and then the dark complected man may have had a radio, right? That he took out and spoke into, and then he tucks into his back pocket, or he tucks into the back of his pants as he's walking away. So it's crazy. I think this leans conspiracy, and I really want to know what's going on with the dark complected man. I think even if you land on the official story with the umbrella man, the dark complected man story needs to be figured out. That's where I land. What about you?
Well, I actually learned, a lot from listening to yours. The umbrella man was an afterthought for me, and I did an episode on it and kind of took the HSCA at its word and just left it at that. That it was just kind of an innocent thing. Actually, Josiah Thompson tells mm-hmm. the story.
Yeah.
About,
yep,
and he believes
yep.
it's very, a very innocent ending to that story. So, obviously a highly credible researcher saying that. And then in listening to your episode, I thought to myself, man, I really blew it. I went back and researched some more, and at least my opinion, I'm with you. I think more should be done on that circumstance. I think there's no doubt that he probably had a radio and the whole thing is strange, and we could have been told a story. But it seems odd that if you can't kind of believe both, right? Like if I think those two, if it was nefarious, were connected, and if they were, then obviously Witt is not credible, and someone would have to destroy the first story as well. So I don't think the two are not interconnected is what I'm saying. I think mm-hmm. you have to, you're going to have to do more deeper research on both. But I'm with you.
Right on.
I don't like what I see there.
What about, I will say, I don't think the umbrella man fired a poison dart from his umbrella or anything. I think we can rule that out. No poison darts. Although it was funny, the HSCA, I went back and watched the video. They're all joking because he's got the umbrella and they're like, oh, don't point that thing at me. And it's like, yeah. Man.
Well, he brought to the HSCA uh-huh. Meeting in his testimony, he actually had retained and brought what he purported to say was the original, the actual umbrella he used that day. By the way, some people believe because it was misty that morning in Dallas, they weren't sure whether the weather was going to clear up or not. Mm-hmm. They assumed it would, that, some people did dress and prepare for some rain. So that part of it, I think that wouldn't even have gotten a ho-hum, as weird as it kind of was, right? It still wouldn't right. have gotten a ho-hum on a day like that had nothing happened. It just became completely bizarre once something did.
True, true. Okay, Jim Hicks, real quick. So another, this is the guy that Jim Garrison thought was the radio man, coordinating everything in Dealey Plaza. And we've already talked about Lee Bauer seeing a guy with a radio. We talked about just now the dark complected man having a radio. There's also an affidavit. I believe it's J.C. Price is the guy's name. He sees a guy running with, he says, a headpiece behind the fence. So, I mean, I took that to mean radio. Is that what you would take a headpiece to mean, radio?
Yeah.
Garrison thought Jim Hicks was sort of running the whole operation. And because there's a picture of him walking, and at least he got this bulge in his back pocket that's like a rectangle, and it's hard to tell what it is. Now, Garrison actually said that wasn't it, and it was like some S-shaped antenna that was in his pants or something. I don't know. I couldn't find it. But so long story short, Hicks goes to New Orleans and he testifies before the grand jury in the Garrison case. He's beat up the night before. And what's funny is, you know, they're like, he was hanging out with his two black friends, and then he got beat up and there's broken, you know, there two other black guys robbed him. So the first two must have set him up, because all black people are friends with each other. It's like, okay.
Terrible, I know.
Hicks tells Garrison that he sees someone fire out of the trunk of a car in the arcade, which I take to mean the area between the school book depository and the grassy knoll, that the sort of that white monument type area. Mm-hmm. But nobody else saw that. And it doesn't seem consistent with any of the other evidence. So I think what Garrison landed on is that he thought he was the radio guy and he thought he was involved, but that he was just basically throwing the game. He's just telling like a ridiculous story because just to keep himself safe. What's weird about that is that Hicks is the one that raised his hand and inserted himself into the Garrison case. So is it disinformation? I don't know. I don't rule out that Hicks did something and was involved, or even that he had a radio. I don't think he was telling Garrison the truth. And so I don't know what we can make of his testimony for the overall puzzle piece. But what do you think?
I don't know. I've, you know, you can get me on any given night with about him. There's some other strange facts about him. You know, he was eventually, committed into a mental hospital. And what's odd about this whole case is if you take the whole population of witnesses, there are a handful of them. I don't know if it's statistically significant that somehow made their way into mental hospital.
Mm-hmm. Ralph Yates is my favorite.
Yeah. You know, so I don't have an opinion on this. I think it is something that there should be more research into.
Let's go to episode 12, Julia Mercer. Let's talk some Julia Mercer. So Julia Mercer sees a truck pull over in Dealey Plaza. And this is what, maybe like an hour or so before the assassination ish, yeah, hour and a half. A man gets out and goes up the hill, basically to what would be where the grassy knoll is, with what she said looked like a rifle. And then the driver looked at her. She made eye contact with him. And the story is that it was Jack Ruby driving the truck. Now, I landed on this one as inconclusive. And the thing the reason I didn't put lean conspiracy on this one is the FBI says that she was shown a photo of Jack Ruby in a lineup, and that she said the guy looked like him, but not that it was him, right? That's kind of plausible. But the bigger thing, and then maybe you have a counterpoint for this, I'd love to hear, her affidavit says that so she had said that, look, there's all these things in the FBI report that I didn't say, and I never said anything about it saying air conditioning on the side of the truck, but it says air conditioning, that it says that she said that it said air conditioning on the side of the truck in her same day affidavit as well. So that was kind of the thing that I latched on to. But what do you think about Julia Mercer? Do you think she did see Jack Ruby and a guy take a gun up the hill, or what are your thoughts on that?
I think she's a highly credible witness for a number of reasons. We don't have to get into the detail of it, but I think she's highly credible. She was absolutely very, very, very fearful. I think the key thing, this is the way Garrison tells it. I don't know whether this is right or wrong. The key thing is that she made her affidavit shortly after on the day of the assassination. She was interviewed first by the FBI on Saturday. It was prior to Jack Ruby shooting Oswald. She states that, or the way the story is stated, is that that is the day in which they showed her the array of pictures that included a picture of Jack Ruby. That's when she was able to pick out Jack Ruby. She was then subsequently interviewed twice after the Sunday shooting in the following week. I think on the 25th and the 27th, I think of the dates. I may be off by day. But they were both the second and the third FBI interview occurred after the shooting. And they did not make a separate report on the first one. They combined the reports, and in those reports, they indicated, okay, that the picture review was done in one of those two subsequent meetings. Made it very, very easy for someone to say, well, you know what? She just got mixed up. And I think she very clearly articulated, she didn't say much, but she did make a personal statement at one point saying that what was in the original affidavit was clearly not correct. It also begs one other question. You have to believe that there was some coordination between the sheriff's office and the FBI to get consistency between the original affidavit, the problems with that, and the problems with the FBI report. But I do believe, I believe it's quite plausible that that's in fact what happened.
So how do you think her affidavit says air conditioning? I mean, if she didn't sign, do you think that's her authentic signature? Like, are you saying they doctored it, or? No,
she very clearly said, actually the one thing she said about that affidavit is very clear that she did say it's not a Garrison thing. That is not her signature. But you know, you have to understand about affidavits too. I mean, and to be fair and to be balanced, in those days, you took an affidavit and somebody else was typing it, and somebody else was actually at sometimes editing those things after they read them. And I mean editing like the police were, then sending them back, then mm-hmm. they were put in front of somebody. I mean, and sometimes they weren't put in front of people, you know. So I think there was a sort of a routine that was followed that you know, also included the hubris of those investigating agencies. And I think you have to put it in a context of the, you know, the time in which they were done. But right. Now, clearly in this case, these were material facts that you know, apparently were altered.
Another thing that's crazy about this whole Julia Mercer, Jack Ruby sighting is the fact that the FBI had a photo of Jack Ruby in their suspect deck.
Why would they have
that's done that's that the story
on,
to me
on Saturday?
Holy moly, what
on Saturday? I mean, you know, I mean, I can understand if that had actually taken place on Monday or Tuesday or whatever. Uh-huh. I mean, he's now, you know, he now right. shot the guy who shot the president. That wouldn't have bothered anybody had that picture been included after Sunday.
But sure,
it was included on Saturday.
I mean, that's wild to me. That's really crazy. So, okay, Julia Mercer, I'm going to revise to inconclusive on that one. You've taken me away from Lean's Warren report. So there you go. Let's talk HSCA. We got just a few more topics. These are all sort of the cornucopia of short little topics. They're in episode 12. The HSCA Dictabelt and then the HSCA overall. And oh my gosh, you probably have several episodes on the HSCA, don't you? You go deep on it.
I don't go thoroughly through it. And to be honest with you, we have not attempted to tackle the Dictabelt question. So I don't really have I have some personal thoughts on it, but I don't have an episode view on it.
So. Yeah. So long story short, a police officer's Dictabelt was left on sort of recording the transmission that's coming from the police radio. And the idea is, hey, they're in this officer's in Dealey Plaza and you can hear the shots from the Dictabelt. I could not really make a whole lot of heads or tails of that recording. It's pretty low quality. I mean, there are things you hear and you go, was that it? Was that the shot? I don't know. Was that it? Was that, you know, like, but I know they did an audio analysis of it, like a waveform analysis. And that's the, you see these little spikes. I think there was four spikes, and that's kind of where they say the shots hit. But here's a rebuttal number five. I just need to correct the record here. I said that the HSCA said that a shot came from the front. That's not what the HSCA said. The HSCA said that a shot probably came from the front. Okay. So I just want to correct the record. The word probably is in there. So they didn't say conclusively. There's a great book by Gayton Fonzie, The Last Investigation, where he talks about what the HSCA investigation was like. And basically he says, look, this is just a political report. And, you know, if you want to hang your hat on, there was a fourth shot fired from the grassy knoll. You can, but you should do that knowing that they also had a report ready to go that almost went live that said there wasn't a fourth shot fired. And really, the conspiracy side of the HSCA isn't the fourth shot, because there's all sort of science that came out afterwards. There's a study in 1982. The FBI says, nah, that's not true. Just like the FBI after Martin Luther King was found to have been killed by the FBI and the Memphis police by a jury, they came out with a report like a year later that said, nah. So now there's a report. There's a counterpoint. There you go. But at any rate, the HSCA, they generated a lot of good evidence. But they weren't allowed to look into, you know, Oswald's background. They weren't allowed to look into, you know, they got a lot of resistance when it came to anything related to Cuba and things that the CIA was doing. And we later learned about George Ioannidis, that's sort of the hot topic these days. But at any rate, I guess you said you haven't really dug deep into the HSCA, but I'm sure you've dug deeper than almost everybody in the world. So what are your thoughts?
Well, a couple of things. Can I say one thing about the Dictabel? I think if you want to hear an incredible rapportee, there is a Sixth Floor Museum, and you may have watched that. It's between Howard Willen, you know, sort of the second in command, of the attorney, the attorneys on the Warren Commission, in a debate with Robert Blakey. And they get into the entire discussion because Howard Willens is an absolute opponent of the technical analysis that was done. And as you know, some of the issues are that there is a group of people who believe that the particular jammed taping, which occurred, you know, was an open channel, which the dictaphone was recorded from, that motorcycle wasn't even in Dealey Plaza. So there's a question as to whether its location was appropriate or not. That's a highly debated thing, I think, in assassination research. And the second thing, in terms of the credibility of that group, Blakey brought in highly, highly credible, you know, groups that did work in other very highly complex areas of the government in terms of acoustical analysis. However, if you see what happened at the end, there was a process where they changed some assumptions. And in changing those assumptions about what they, you know, how they were processing the data, statistically, they were able to say, you know, with greater certainty that there was probably a fourth shot. And so there was some, and as we all know, if you're a numbers person or you deal with in math, you know, there's a way, you know, to approach things that statistically you can do that. There was no definitive in any of that. It's a great debate. Blakey's not at his best, unfortunately, because he was beginning, I think, to, you know, they're getting older. Although I will say Howard Willens was absolutely amazing in that. And if you get a chance to listen to it, it goes to the core of what you're talking about there. On the HSCA, you know, in business, I've been in corporate America most of my life. And when you choose a leader, you choose for various reasons. And sometimes, you know, boards choose individuals because they can control them. Sometimes boards choose individuals because they know they want to, you know, they want a disruptor. The original people assigned to run the HSCA were disruptors. They were, and they were trained, highly trained in investigative technique.
Right. Yeah. And they got replaced.
They were gone. They were gone almost immediately. And as a result of that, you put a guy like Blakey in charge, who's obviously good man. And I think quite an honest guy, but at the end of the day, and he had, you know, connections, you know, with the Kennedy family. He had worked in the Justice Department. His focus had been obviously organized crime. He wrote the RICO statute. He's an amazingly accomplished guy. But at the end of the day, the investigation was almost dead on arrival as soon as that happened, because there was going to be a, you know, a bent on that. And he got later, if you listen to him, he's very clear that he got duped by the CIA. At the end of the day, his cooperation agreement with them was such that, you know, they weren't able to, they didn't comply.
Buell Wesley Frazier, let's talk about him. There's a lot to talk about, but specifically, I want to narrow it down to a very small thing, which is his testimony, not testimony, but his statement in 2021. He gave a talk at the Sixth Floor Museum right before his book was coming out. And he said that he saw a guy with a rifle and a super fancy hat in the parking lot, you know, and that, you know, he had just buried this memory and he just remembered it and he was too afraid before. But he thinks that this was the guy that shot Kennedy. So I don't know. What do you make of that?
I don't think it's very credible.
And
I'm disappointed, because I would have said up to that, to the moment of those kind of statements, that and he's had some detractors, but I would have said up to that moment that he was a highly believable as a young witness, and even in his older years. So is it possible? And you don't want to poo-poo somebody who was a prime witness. Mm-hmm. Who quite frankly might have seen something, but it seems so improbable given his high profile juxtaposition in this, you know, passion play, that all of a sudden something of that nature would be revealed. He had no reason not to reveal it much earlier in life. So
right.
I don't get it. I don't.
All right, let's talk about Eugene Brading. Hey. So, or Jim Braden, basically he's a mafia guy. We have some good documents from the IRS and I believe some FBI reports that establish, let's call him Brading, that establish Brading's bona fides with the mafia. And so there's not really a question of, was he a mafia guy, but he's arrested in the Daltex building, which is the one right behind the school book depository. Some people think the shots came from the Daltex building, and he's arrested on the third floor. And he says that basically he was coming down the street after he happened to be in Dallas for a meeting, on oil business with H.L. Hunt. Okay. Who's one of the characters that some people think may be involved in the assassination. And he, after the meeting, he's walking down the street and he sees all these cops around the school book depository. He doesn't know what happened. And he asks this girl in front of the Daltex building if he can use a phone. He goes inside, gets in the elevator. Elevator attendant recognizes him as not being someone who works there, calls the police. He's arrested and he has to give a statement. And that's why we have this affidavit from Eugene Brading, although he gave his name as Jim Braden in the affidavit. The other thing is that Jack Ruby also met with H.L. Hunt the same day, and Brading shared office space, not literally. He was on the same floor, a couple of doors down on the 17th floor. I forget the name of the building in New Orleans, but he's right next to David Ferry. And this is the months before the assassination.
Yeah, G. Ray Gill, actually, the lawyer that represented Carlos, you know.
Okay. Yeah. So that's where he was. Okay. So you know, I mean, I don't think there's any, I think it's weird that he was there. And it's just another one of those things that goes like, look, if you find more evidence later, as we get down the road, that, you know, if the medical evidence looks like it's a conspiracy, and if there's other people, and there's all, you know, then it's set up that it could be that, but we just haven't established it on this information alone. But yeah, Eugene Brading's a shady guy. What do you think?
Well, I mean, you know, I sat there and listened to, you know, what you said, and you've made the case for, again, one of these, like, really, I mean, how, have you ever seen the show Homeland, you know, where they get up there and they got all the pictures of the people, and they draw the strings between the things, and there are all these intersections. I mean, he's a great example. So if he saw him, so it, you know, if that did occur and they were in the same office on the same day with Hunt, and then they saw him, you know, each other that, I mean, and then you got, you know, and then they've got, you know, some level of, you know, analysis of him and the other characters that he dealt with, you know, within the Chicago mob family. I mean, how much do you need to understand that there's some level of connection? Why was he just there? And then he's down the hall. Then he's two doors down the hall from G. Ray Gill, who handled all of the legal business for Carlos Marcellus. So yes, totally circumstantial. So what, right? Some people might say, so what, you know, but it's, there's a lot of, this is one that you actually, what I wonder is, why didn't they pursue this more heavily? You know, he seems to me like he would have been one that, and I think, you know, obviously Garrison wanted to. The thing they hang their hat on the Braden thing is that, you know, he ended up changing his name just before the assassination, and he used a credit card to identify himself. And because the credit card had his new identification on it, you know, when they ran priors on him, there was nothing. So that was an easy, I mean, you know, okay, so that sounds pretty fishy, but it, you know, does it mean anything? No, because the guy was a swindler. And what a lot of people don't know is he'd been in Dallas many years before. I don't know if you heard that story, but Decker didn't like him. And Bill Decker effectively threw him out of Dallas.
Wow.
And, 10 years before. So he married several women and taken their money. And I think it might've been a friend of Decker's. I don't know, but
yeah,
that kind of thing, you know, this is a backstory on all this.
Yeah. Yeah, no doubt. Well, listen to the JFK, The Enduring Secret, and we'll get the backstory. All right. Two more issues here. There's these three law enforcement officers who are going to pick up a, it looks like they're, you know, the one guy's reaching down to pick up a bullet, his hands cupped when it comes up. And there's the question of, there's two separate questions. Was a bullet recovered? Which, you know, there's a lot of people who say that Buddy Walters told people that he got a bullet. There's four or five people on the record saying that. That's issue number one. Issue number two is there evidence of a fourth shot, whether the bullet was recovered or not, right? So you've got the one cop who says that you know, it, a bullet hit the man, went off the manhole and into the grass and then came out. And there's an FBI report that says this is not lined up with the curb strike, which is what hit James Tague. So that means it has to be an independent, a different shot. I think where I landed was maybe, but they did, you know, pick up a bullet. We don't know. I thought it was funny. During the Garrison investigation, a newspaper reporter interviewed Walters and asked him, did you pick up a bullet? And he goes, no, it wasn't a bullet. If anything, it was just like a piece of like skull or something. Like, who cares?
He put it in his pocket. Like, can you imagine somebody saying that? What a great, he didn't think too much about his alternative articulation of that, did he?
Yeah. So anyway, it sounds to me, and there's Edna and forget the husband's name, but the Hartmans, there's an FBI report that where they saw a gouged out space in the grass in the same area. They sort of support the story. So it's not overwhelming evidence, but when you zoom into it, it does kind of, it leans towards there being evidence of a fourth shot, if not a collection of the bullet, in my view. What is your thought?
Well,
what are they all looking at and talking about then is the question, you know,
strictly from an evidential standpoint, you know, we're arguing over missing evidence. And so it's hard to make a conclusion on that. I think one of the elements surrounding it. And if you talk to Roger Craig about it, who, you know, the question is whether or not he's credible on this particular aspect of testimony. He would describe Buddy Walters as a scoundrel, and you know, with a real sort of a real climber, a guy who'd do probably almost anything, a guy who was actually at one point kind of, you know, penned in, so to speak, by the Dallas Police Department as having even fenced stolen goods. I mean, he's just a bad guy. Mm. But he was Decker's sort of pet project. And if that's true, then it would be easier to believe that they found something and somebody got to them and they just pushed, you know, they put the evidence aside. I think there is an overwhelming, when you just listen to everything, all the evidence, all the testimony, probably an overwhelming narrative that started early enough, right after the assassination, that if there was evidence accumulating contrary to the idea that there was a lone gunman, that it was probably shelved in some way. And that's probably a great example. It is a great example of a piece of evidence that meets that criteria. So he may have very well had good intentions, but have been under the pressure that was placed on everyone. Overtly or covertly, to just hold off. And but the point is, we don't know. I mean, I don't think it's all speculation, every right. bit of it. And Garrison describes it as you can see the bullet. Do you see the bullet?
I don't see a bullet either. I mean, there's a newspaper headline where they have a picture of grass and they go, this is where a bullet hit, and you know, the assassin's bullet struck here. But no, I don't see a bullet at all. I see the guy's hand being cupped when he hits the ground, and when he comes back up, it's plausible there's something in his hand. But I don't know. I mean, that one's just, there's so many of these that you've listened to them and you go, well, where does this fit? If true, how does this fit with what the other guys say? All right, last substantive issue, then we'll do a wrap-up question here. Was Beverly Oliver the babushka lady? So the babushka lady is this woman that she's got her head wrapped in a, it looks like a Russian hat, like a babushka. And she had a camera. And so the question is, what's on the camera and who was this lady? Because we don't know who she was. She's like the umbrella man or the dark complected man. We don't know their existence, really. Maybe the umbrella man's a whip, but whatever, you get my point. So the question is, who was that? Well, this woman came forward, Beverly Oliver. She told Gary Shaw, apparently at a church revival, I found out, in 1970, that you know, she was the babushka lady. And I was a little bit suspicious of Oliver, but what I was interesting was that Shaw did and by the way, I met Gary Shaw in Dallas, and I hung out with him for two different instances socially, and he's a very, very nice guy. Really like Gary Shaw. Thumbs up to Gary Shaw. Just a very pleasant, nice man. Anyway, he had seen the Zapruder film, and he knew that Beverly Oliver had not seen it. So he asked her, where were you? And he met with her in Dealey Plaza, and she goes, I was standing right here. And lo and behold, it's the spot where the babushka lady was. So to him, that kind of verified it. The reason people say she's not the babushka lady is because she then claims all these things that, you know, maybe they're true, but they're quite fantastical if it is true. So she says that she knew Ruby and that Ruby introduced her to Oswald, which is big. And but then she says that this dancer that was there that saw it named Jada, and turns out Jada was fired a month earlier. The issues I have with Beverly Oliver, you know, they'd said her camera, the camera that she said she had didn't exist at the time. And then this is kind of cleared up when she talks to the ARRB, and it's like, well, I never said that and whatever. So her credibility comes into question for me, based on something that I read where she was at a conspiracy conference and she told all these people that she had found an image from her camera, and it turned out to be a zoomed in image of the Knicks film that everybody already knew. And everyone's like, oh, this is sad. This is sad because we all know you're lying. So I think that's the thing that really, really hurt her in my eyes. But I don't know your thoughts on Beverly Oliver and then maybe the Babushka lady generally.
Yeah. Well, you know, I like her. She's incredibly entertaining. I think she was right in the thick of things at the club. I think she worked at the club, you know, the club next door. And I think she did, you know, hang with Jack Ruby from time to time. In fact, I think I've seen at least one picture with them together. So I think there was a connection there. I think this is my personal, you know, observation of it. I think she wants to be important in the story. And, you know, and there's a lot of people like that. And I think a lot of what she says is probably true. I think she's not always a precision talker. And almost everybody that gets involved in this, you know, has about 1,000 pundits out there that hang on every word that is said, and they can, you know, they can repeat what was wrong with what was just said. And so, you know, if you look at her background, I would not be surprised that there are times that maybe she talked fast and loose about a topic and it wasn't exactly right. So here's the issue. Like, if you're a juror, you know, you get instructions to say, if you think one thing is wrong with a witness, you can disregard everything that a witness says. You have the ability to do that. Most, you know, that's mostly court procedure, correct? So, you know, you're the lawyer here, Matt.
Yeah, but definitely.
I would say that, you know, in life, you know, that's not always the case, right? Like, good, honest people sometimes, you know, embellish stories. They do all sorts of things that aren't exactly, you know, for lots of reasons, exactly right. And I think she's a great example of somebody that you should probably be suspect of when you hear a little bit about that. Now, on the camera, okay, the camera is a good example of where you could just discount her. However, you know, I've talked to some camera experts, and there were at the time there were moments where they, you know, there were experimental cameras that were available. She might have had one, mm-hmm. and the idea that you sent back the you know, you had to send the film back to Kodak for processing and all that, you know, all that's true. It probably is right. So, I mean, is it possible, you know, that, yeah, it's possible, although it's shaky, you know, because of the inconsistencies. You have to wonder. I don't think she's the Babushka lady, though. I mean, I'll tell you why. First of all, when you look at that picture, you know, she must have had a whole lot of stuff stuffed inside, you know, that thing, because she's, you know, young.
Right. The lady's a lot more heavy set than her. Yeah.
Young lady. And I don't think that's the person that's in that, And now she claims she goes to some of the conferences, and she brings the pairs of shoes with her.
Have you met her?
What's that? No, I haven't, but I've listened to one where she was doing that. Uh-huh. And, you know, and so she might very well be telling the truth, but there's another theory. And I'll tell you, one of the theories, out there, which is talking about far out, is that there may have been a communications person that was in that setup that day as the Babushka lady, and if you believe something like that, and you know that that person will never be identified, and she's heard enough about what, you know, the alternative views are on this, that there's a theory that she's adopted that character because she knows nobody else will claim it. And you know, and that's an interesting theory. I don't know, you know, I don't know whether that's right or wrong. I'm not, and I'm not even saying she's not telling the truth here. I'm just saying that as people evaluate, you know, what the, you know, what the possibilities are, that's something that's been presented to me.
Sure.
I do. Listen, I will tell you, I think she has some credibility. I think maybe not necessarily on all on this topic, but I think she was around. You know, she claims to have known Jim LaValle and spent a reasonable amount of time with him in Dallas. She claims to have known Roscoe White.
Mm-hmm.
You know, she claims that's how they found her. I don't know if you've ever heard this that story, but that's how she claims. And she claims that Regis Kennedy is the one, you know, FBI agent that actually took her film. So, you know, again, there's a lot to unpack with her.
Yeah,
that probably requires more critical thinking to determine which parts you think are accurate or not.
Right. Well, one wrap up question here, Jeff, and thanks again for spending time with us today and being on this episode and of Recaps and Rebuttals. From everything we looked at, and I'm gonna ask you to do something kind of tough, not considering the medical evidence. Just hard for, you know, so much about this case, it's hard for you to unknow things. But do you think, just based on the things we talked about today, based on just the issues and the witnesses we talked about today, do you think that's enough to establish a grassy knoll shooter? Or do you think that that alone isn't enough and we'd have to go look at other other evidence?
Yeah, I don't think it's enough. I think my personal opinion is that you have to look at the forensics. I don't know how you can look at a case like this and not understand the forensics to get some more definitive conclusions as to whether or not there was a shot
right
that came at the president. And by the way, it's not just the medical evidence. You know, again, I'm sure you're going to do
ballistics and stuff like that as well. Is that when you say it's not just the medical evidence, you mean like ballistic evidence and
even the windshield. I mean,
the windshield. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, there's all of that. I think all of it is required totality. I don't think you can take any of this in isolation.
But it's so, yeah, I agree with what you said, but it's also true, I don't want to put words in your mouth. Would you say that it's true that based on what we talked about, that doesn't rule out a grassy knoll shooter? It's open-ended.
Yeah. First of all, I think it's quite possible that there was a grassy knoll shooter, but I go back. Can I say this to you? I'm pretty clear on what I think, and it may sound like I just sort of gravitate to a conspiracy theory, but I've tried to be very evidential in the entire, through the entire process. And I think a sophisticated reviewer of all of this information would not make a conclusion on one thing.
Sure.
I don't think you should. Unless in a film, or unless it was very clear you could actually see the shots being taken from that point, which that's when it's game over.
Right.
I actually don't think any of these other things are. I mean, yeah, I know we want to describe them that way.
Uh-huh.
I don't think they are. I don't think they are in and of themselves a game over piece of evidence. I think they all fit into the puzzle like all the rest of this does.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, to me, you've got Ed Hoffman and Gordon Arnold, and let's set them off to the side, because if what they said is true, that, I mean, maybe Hoffman more so than Gordon Arnold, but if what they said is true, that kind of is the smoking gun. I mean, if in fact it is true, but we don't know if it's true or not. And then you combine that with, you know, the Tip O'Neill stuff, Nix and Tague and Newman, all these people in Dealey Plaza saying the shots came from the grassy knoll, it leaves it open so that it could. You know, there very well could be, based on everything we've looked at, it's absolutely plausible that there could have been a grassy knoll shooter. And if there was, then Hoffman saw it and Bauer saw it, but it doesn't establish it. It just leaves it open. And we have to kind of go see, are there any other facts that just beat us over the head and go, hey, it had to be a conspiracy. And if so, then it's there for us. And if not, then it remains open. And if, you know, later it's proven that, oh, definitely it was the medical evidence shows that it was Oswald, you know, there was a shot from the back and that's all, and there's no issues there, then maybe there wasn't anybody on the grassy knoll. That's kind of how I'm looking at it, is sort of punting.
Well, obviously, Matt, you're highly analytical. And I think everyone has a threshold. I am going to be, you asked me a very specific question. You asked me to unlearn the medical evidence. Okay. I'm not going to say anything more. I'd be very interested in where you land after you look at the medical evidence. And I will tell you, you know, where I land after you listen to the medical evidence, because I have a very clear understanding of what the answer to your question is when you consider the totality of everything.
Well, careful what you ask for. I might have to ask you to come back for the medical evidence recap. But yeah, hey, really appreciate your time today, and I know you've got things going on, and like I said, I think you have the number one JFK assassination podcast that exists. And I appreciate the kind words you said about this podcast. And it's been a pleasure talking to you, Jeff.
Yes, same here. And I just one other postscript. If you keep it up, and you know, this is sort of like I say this is Forrest Gump, you know, in the middle of the desert with that. You know, that group of groupies behind them. If you get to 156, okay, you don't even have to get to 156, because you'll do what I've done in a lot less in a more efficient way. You're going to have the best podcast. I mean, I am absolutely just excited about what you're doing, and I can't wait for the next one to come out. So,
oh man, that's really nice. Thanks, Jeff. I appreciate it. And again, it's JFK, The Enduring Secret, available everywhere that you can find podcasts, and Jeff Crudele. So thanks again, Jeff. We appreciate it, man.
Thank you, Matt.